special moment. We want to have a special observance to families and veterans who lost a veteran to suicide for this particular special moment. We just post the colors. Next will be the national anthem. National anthem will be sung by Marine Chip Shields. Chip.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bomb bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the
Great job, Chip. Great job. So now I want to introduce the pastor who will give the invocation and also a short script. Pastor DJ Springman is the pastor for Indian Rocks Baptist Church. And the reason why we asked him, he graciously accepted him to give the invocation and a bit of a speech, because Pastor Springman is the one that actually provided funeral services for Joe Razor, Marine, who died by suicide. So I figured that he'll have that special insight on what it really takes and what it all means when you actually have a funeral of veterans who died by suicide. I'd now like to introduce you, Pastor Springman.
Thank you, Ellsworth. I hope you guys can hear me okay. Wanted to just say thank you personally to all the families that are watching, all the loved ones that are watching, and to know that this is a special day. It's a special day, and this occasion to be able to come together, whether it's you're there personally or remotely, to remember loved ones that we've lost. And, you know, as I think about today, I think about sacrifice. And as a parent or a loved one, it's very normal for us to try to protect the ones that we love. And yet, as your loved one answered the call to serve for his or her country, you release them, and you release them to serve others. And as we come together today, we realize that their life was not spent in vain. In fact, we take today to remember them. And I would say this, as people that have never served in battle, myself being one, never seen war firsthand, as some of your loved ones have, we need to be reminded truly of what these men and women, their friends and family, their loved ones, what they gave up when they put on the uniform and committed to serve their country. Today, I can't say that I totally understand the pain and the loss that you're going through. I have two boys of my own, 18 and 21. One of them wants to join in the service and serve. And so to say today, though, that I can identify with the loss, I can only say that I can't even imagine the loss of a son or a daughter or a friend, a loved one, like many of us have lost. But that's why this gathering is so important. I think sometimes And oftentimes there's a feeling of being alone, and you're not alone. But for me, it's also important that trust is a big issue. And I know for many of you that are listening, even today, is maybe the thought is there's no one really knows what I'm going through, what I've experienced, the loss, the grief that I'm going through. And today I just wanted to share with you just a word of encouragement from Scripture. Being a man of faith, I believe in Jesus Christ, and I believe he loves us, he loves you. And one of my favorite verses in Scripture, which it describes him in Isaiah 53, it says, "He was despised and rejected of men. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not." And so today I want to just encourage you that as you are dealing, for some of you, friends and family and loved ones that have lost someone special to you in your life, know that there's someone who cares, your Creator. He's someone that can identify with you, with loss and with sorrow and with grief. You know, it says in Scripture to cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you. And I want to speak specifically here to those that might be listening that are questioning. First of all, is God there? Do people care? Does he care? Let me encourage you by this word that says in Scripture that you were created by him and for him. And so today we acknowledge, as part of his creation, you were created on purpose and for a purpose. And so today, as you are maybe going through a dark day, as you recall the loss of those that you served alongside in battle, I'm not denying the fact that you've probably seen some pretty horrific things. But can I tell you this? Use that pain and that suffering that you have for a purpose. There's others that are grieving and others who are hurting right now as you are. And can I encourage you to use that pain, to use that suffering to reach out to someone else? You're not alone. You are loved, and you will get through this. So at this time, I just wanted to end in a word of prayer just for the rest of the service today, and for the families who have lost loved ones, and for those who are contemplating taking their own lives. I want to pray for you right now. Father, we come before you today, this evening, as a group, not only on campus there, but so many watching online. Lord, I pray that if there's someone tonight that is just in so much pain and grief from loss, Father, that you would heal their hearts. Let them know that you care for them. You've said for us to cast our cares on you. And Lord, I lift up those right now who are maybe contemplating taking their own life, Father. I pray that you would lift them up, give them encouragement, even tonight as they would watch this, that some of the words that are shared from your word and listening to other testimonies, let them know that their life is important and it's valued, God, and that you can give them purpose. And Lord, they can take the pain and the suffering and the hurt and change it into something beautiful through you. And so I lift them up to you tonight. God, continue to be with this service. May it honor and glorify, and may it bring comfort and healing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank Amen. You.
Thank you very much, Pastor Springer. That was good. We appreciate that. It's well felt. And it was very appropriate for today's ceremony. One of the things that I want to turn to is that a lot of you guys out there, I'm actually broadcasting from American Legion Post 5 next to the cemetery. And I want to give a small tribute to George William Hamlin. And why I'm doing that is because Bill, we call him Bill here at the Commander, he's been very, very supportive when it comes to veteran suicide. In fact, when I just moved here to Tampa and I was trying to find a service home, I came to this post, and after the event, Bill called me the next day and said, "Hey, Tony, I really appreciate you being here." And I said, sir, I asked you two things to know if I want to join your post. He said, what are they? First, I said, are you actively involved in the veteran community? And Bill says, Tony, that's all we do. We are actively involved in the veteran community. Then I said, Bill, I just created a nonprofit called Veterans Counseling Veterans, and I really want to start doing things for the community. Will you support me? He said, yes. But Bill's not somebody that just says words. He actually is, it's actually about action. So our very first, my harebrained idea was to have on Memorial Day, we were standing on Bayshore Boulevard with signs saying, Florida Veterans Lives Matter, Suicide Prevention. And Bill was out there, it was like 90,000 degrees and sweating. He was out there, and him and Rosemary. And he was there from the start and beginning. And I can tell you, for those who don't know, Bill sadly passed away in February. And because of this COVID-19, we couldn't do things to sit there and really show him how much he missed him. And I miss Bill, because I guarantee you, if Bill was around, he would be right here and part of this podcast. And he'd be here right now at ceremony, I'm sorry. And he'd be here right now introducing himself as a post commander for American Legion Post 5. So I just want to give that tribute to him. I also want to give a tribute to Rosemary, because she was there with them. In fact, one of the things I did when I was a veteran affairs, we had chair for the district. We had training, a two-day training on suicide prevention. And Rosemary and Bill were there for that training. That's just how much dedicated they are for taking care of the veterans and their families. So I want to give about a one minute, somebody on can look at the clock, a 1 minute moment of silence for George William Hamlin, former post commander of Post 5 American Legion. Thank you very much for that tribute. Now, I would like to introduce one of our guest speakers of testimony, Carol Razor Cordero. Carol Razor Cordero, we go back a long way. She's been a strong supporter of Veterans Council Veterans, but how we met was kind of like I always say, she used to be saying, it's a God moment. Because basically I always say veteran suicide when I go to the Veterans Council, and we got Hillsborough Veterans Council. And I always talk about veteran suicide. And then Tony Gross sits there and says, I know of a mother who lost her son to suicide, Marine, Joe Razor. And will you go? I said, of course I'll go. And that was one of the most, I would say the most substantial moment for Veterans Council Veterans, because I went to the funeral. I didn't know anybody there, but I just saw a lot of my brothers and sisters there. And it was the most emotional moment I could ever experience. And I looked at God. I was tearful. I was out of sorts. We all in uniform that night, and I said to God, and you gotta be careful when you say things to God, because he has a habit of answering. I said, God, what can I do? What can I do for this mother who's in anguish? And God said, create a program to support veterans and their families, and called it VVOS, Outreach Support Suicide and Suicide Survivors. And I asked Carol, would she lead it? Carol said, absolutely. And Carol has been with me since then, and all that time there, and we've become great friends. She's now part of the board of Veterans Council of Veterans. And I want to have Carol come up and give a few words on what she's experienced about when she first found out that Joe died by suicide, and she had to go through that chaotic moment to go there. So Carol.
Thank you, Tony, and I just want to compliment Tony on all the good work that Veterans Counseling Veterans is doing, and I also want to follow up on what Pastor Springman had said. I can't tell you how important it was to me being at the lowest point in my life to have reach out to God and have him steer me in the direction I needed to go and how to deal with Joe. And for any of you out there, I would like to say, in your lowest time, turn to God first before you turn to anyone else, because he really has the answers. But I'm here today to talk about Joe, but first I would like to honor the men and women that have served our country so bravely. whether they died on the battlefield or whether they died on our own soil from the visible or invisible injuries they sustained while in battle. They're all true heroes to us. Each has a unique story about his or her life, but they all have the commonality that these veterans shared the love for country and a willingness to sacrifice their lives for our freedom. To me, this is the most honorable trait an American can have, but not all Americans are willing to make the sacrifice. Those willing to serve and protect our freedom are the most precious resource that this country has. Let us not forget this as a nation. My son Joseph attended Indian Rocks Christian School from the time he was in pre-K through 12th grade. And came 12th grade, all he talked about was becoming a U.S. Marine. And shortly, a few days after graduation, that's exactly what he did. Joe served with the U.S. Marines, the 3rd Battalion, 24th Marines. He served in Iraq and Afghanistan. His MOSs were logistics vehicle system operator, machine gunner, combat marksman trainer, and combat marksman coach. He also served as a contractor for L3 Communications and was deployed to Afghanistan to serve as a combat marksmanship coach to train the Afghan military. He also graduated from St. Pete College with a bachelor's degree in public safety and started graduate school at USF. What I can tell you as a mother is that there is nothing more shocking than to be told that your son died by suicide. I was in law enforcement for 25 years. I worked for the Pinellas County Sheriff's Office. And one night, April 21st at 3 a.m, I had two officers that I knew came to the door and said to my husband at that time, is Carol here? And the first thing I said to him, is it Joe or is it Aaron? Because I have delivered death notifications myself. And they told me it was Joe. There's nothing more overwhelming than that, because what was difficult for me is I knew every time he came back from deployment, he seemed a little bit different, but I knew life experiences do change people. But he always had a lot of friends. He was very outgoing. He was, you know, the life of the party. And he never talked to me about anything really negative that happened over in Iraq or Afghanistan. He always kept it to the amusing stories. I knew he was going to the VA initially, and I thought he was going for a back injury, but subsequently, after contacting the VA, he was going there for post-traumatic and depression. And so he lost that battle. But I think on the other side of things is that he accomplished so much with his life. And for me, I am so proud that God gave me the opportunity to be his mother. I also would like to share with you my rejoicement in that remembering our fallen National Memorial was now included to include our nation's post 9/11 military who served in a war zone but succumbed to the invisible wounds suffered from the battlefield, and now they'll be included in the memorial. I think this brings national recognition to the terrible effects war has on our men and women and those that maybe did not die on the battlefield, but they came home and died a very slow death. As a college professor and as a first responder, I know the trauma that the military and first responders experience, and it's a very, very difficult occupation to be in. But I'm so thankful that they are now including those that have suffered from post-traumatic from service in this national memorial. Actually, I think it took a little bit too long because post-traumatic and depression have affected so many of our military personnel, and we need to work with them. It takes a whole community to do that. As Tony Williams have coined so well, it's a national problem with a local solution. So we need all types of organizations, whether it's churches, whether it's Blue Star Moms, Gold Star Moms, other nonprofits to work together to help reduce and bring an end to this military suicide epidemic. Thank you.
Thanks, Carol. And so eloquently stating kind of the struggles we go through as parents or and or family members or friends, and we lose a veteran to suicide. I can tell you it's chaotic. And it's really acutely experienced when you're part of a unit and one of your fellow veterans or service members die by suicide. It just ripples through the unit like you just don't know, and it causes a contagion. And if we don't sit there and really recognize how this can one suicide can affect another, we're really going to lose this battle. So I thank you for that, Carol, and hopefully we continue on this. I always ask, you know, one thing I always said about suicide is that this in itself is a prevention, because when people start seeing just how much it affects the families, they really think twice about ending their lives. A lot of times, veterans think that they're making their family lives better by dying by suicide, and they're definitely not. Thank you, Carol, again. So now what I want to introduce is Chaplain Linda Pugsley is somebody who has been supporting veterans, counseling veterans for several years. And I was so excited when she told me that she could be part of this ceremony. And one thing about Linda is that, you know, Linda came in, you know, during the time when she came as a nurse in Vietnam and a nurse. And then God called her, like he does a lot of people, and called her into ministry. And she is a great advocate. She knows how to sit there and connect the word to the spirit to the family, and just makes it a lot of common sense. And you leave there just shaking your head. So I'm so honored to have Linda be part of this ceremony. Linda, welcome, and ready to hear your words.
Thank you so much, Tony. I appreciate being here. And Carol, it's always a tender time when you have to share the things that you have shared. And when Tony talked about dying, and you talked about dying on the battlefield, I think we all died on the battlefield, just some of us came home. It's extremely, extremely difficult. But as I've said previously, I wish we were all at a happier event, and that somehow we could rewind the clock and have all that's happened disappear, but we can't. Facing the future as whole and healthy as possible is what we now work for. But how do we get there? Very often after such a traumatic event of a loved one's suicide, even more tragedy piles on. Families often disintegrate. People are often unable to deal with the intense grief and the painful, often unanswerable question of why. And it's not just the immediate family that's affected. It's coworkers, neighbors, classmates, and close friends. Waves of emotion can often derail our own healing. Life just seems to stop. We experience anger, guilt, fear. Some even experience relief knowing that the individual's suffering is finally over. But we need to realize that we're not alone. Some of you are aware of a fairly famous Christian pastor for a number of years ago, Rick Warren. His son died by suicide. And you all are familiar with Robin Williams, very famous comedian and actor, and he died by suicide. And Aaron Hernandez, I'm from the Boston area. He's a famous Boston Patriots football player. He died by suicide in his jail cell. Two of my classmates from nursing school died by suicide with drug overdoses. I heard about it a few months later. I wasn't even able to be there. I was in Vietnam at the time. And to hear about it afterwards, really, it was such a long time that it was a very difficult thing to deal with, because you're so far away and yet you're so close to them, and it is extremely difficult. While working as a chaplain with the Florida Army National Guard, one of our soldiers died by suicide, as did the wife of another soldier. It's very, very difficult. I can remember, I can still sense it today at the ceremony for this young soldier. I remember walking up to the casket and, you know, I can still feel it today as I share it. And I just cried out to him and I said, why didn't you talk to me? You know, it's difficult. They often can't talk to anyone. But when we have an opportunity to speak with someone, we have to be very, very open to them. We have to ask them, do you want to end your life or do you want to end your pain? Most times they just want to end the pain. And in that way, sometimes that can be helped. And a couple of years ago, I was called to counsel to be with an Air Force auxiliary unit where one of the cadets had just died by suicide. His girlfriend had just broken up with him and he went to her front lawn and just put a gun to his head and ended his life. Death by suicide, this is a different kind of grief. And we have to understand that. It's not just the death of a loved one. That already is a tremendous loss to the family and all those involved. It's very often dealing with a social stigma that's attached to suicide. And that's very unfortunate. The struggle of the people who think it's better to end their life, either for themselves or others, what a weight, what a viewpoint. And to have a stigma against that, oh my. We really need to help our community to understand what's going on. People often don't know how to react to us, to comfort our families because of a death by suicide. And for anyone outside looking in, they have no clue what to do or what we're going through. For those that are stuck with the guilt of the what ifs, the surviving families and the friends that have to deal with. Now it's all of this, the why, the what if. It's the funeral, it's the finances, the paperwork, the probate, insurance issues. I mean, this is all on top of this very unique situation of a death by suicide. So I just really urge anyone that's listening, talking about what happened is vital. It is vital to be able to do that, and it is a huge part of the healing process. I would like to encourage us, just for a few moments, you can survive someone dying by suicide. Your life can go on. You may not feel it right now, but it's a long and painful journey, but it can be done, just like Carol. She has now restructured her life in honor of her son to help others. How powerful. And I used to say that to many of my Vietnam veteran friends who are still suffering from the loss and the confusion and the PTSD. And I often encourage them and I say, look, we best honor those who have passed on by having a full life, by living our lives for them, for the things they couldn't do, go places they couldn't, be something they couldn't. That is the best way to honor them, to honor their lives, because they are not able to because they are gone. So even though it's a long and painful journey, it can be done. Stay connected with other family members. The last thing you need to do is to be isolated, and yet that happens in families. Families often break apart. Stay connected as much as is possible with you. Give children special attention because they often have a very difficult time dealing with these intense emotions that they're feeling. And remind them it's normal to have that grief, to have that loss, to have that sense of, I don't know who I am or what's going on. It's really okay. Tell them that they are still loved, that it's going to be okay. Holidays, they're tough. Be aware of that. Yellow lights need to go off there in terms of the holidays. Be aware of that and help each other. It takes time to survive, and you may not think you can. You may not think you will, but you will. If you have a spiritual base, lean on God to help you get through. That has been my sustenance and the sustenance of many. Now, getting past your feelings is important, but it doesn't mean you forget. It just means that you become functional again, instead of dysfunctional and unable to go on and live. Your loved one, even though it was a death by suicide, they still would want you to live if they could come back and say, oh, don't do that. And sometimes people, they're not in their right mind. I don't mean mentally ill. I mean, there's so much pressure and stress and confusion and all the things that are going on in a precious soul that sometimes they're not even aware of the magnitude of what they're doing. And sometimes it's almost like, I'm going to do this and I'll tell you about it later. No, it's final. But that's not in the thought process. But your life is important to them. And to live it with honor is going to be the best honor to them. Understand that those intense emotions are perfectly normal response to grief. And it will be intense. Take it one day at a time. And don't be around people who tell you how to feel. Only you know how to feel. Only you know what you feel. And only you know how you'll get through it. And it's going to be at your own pace. Make no comparisons. Anyone that's listening, don't compare yourself to someone else or whatever. It's going to have to be at your own pace. And expect some setbacks, because some days are going to be diamonds and some days are going to be stone. I would like to just encourage you also to put off any major decisions if you can, because in the immediate aftermath of a suicide, things are just not working all right up there. There's too much coming at you. There's too many things to be done and thought of. And very often, it's just not the time to make an important life decision. When your heart and your soul settles down and it's a little clearer, then you and your family can make some other decisions. And it really is okay to get professional help. Some people think, no, I don't need that or whatever. Yes, you do. It's really okay to get that professional help. And when you need to talk, call someone. Reach out, call someone. There's a whole, Tony has set up an entire system of calling and connection to stay in that contact. And be a good listener if someone calls you. Listen to them and understand. Sometimes you just have to get it off your heart. And that good listener is going to be one of the best things that can happen to you. So you be a good listener also. Learn to say no. You need to set limits for yourself. You cannot fix everyone in your world. You need to set limits for yourself. Be patient with yourself and others. And also, there has to be an acceptance. You will never be the same again. But it doesn't mean you can't enjoy life ever again. You can and you will. You will eventually begin to feel something again. It's numb for a long while, but you'll be able to feel something again. Whether it's by passing of time or deep prayer or whatever your spiritual system is, helping others as you have, Carol, finding a new purpose in life. As you go through this, it will happen. And love is a powerful healer. Express your love for the loved one that you lost to suicide, as well as to yourself and to those that are still around you, because they need you more than ever. And the most important things that you can do, again, as I said, to seek professional bereavement counseling, to go to a grief group. Those that are connected with the VA, those that are connected here, I mean, there are so many. If you need any help and assistance, you can make a call. And many of you have the information and the access to what Tony's programs are. And in joining a support group, it doesn't mean you're weak. It means you're strong enough to go to help yourself and help others. It's immensely important. In finishing, I just want to tell you that you are strong. You are not at fault for what has happened, and you can get through this. Stay in touch with each other. Stay in touch with God. And be mightily blessed on your healing journey. God is with you.
Thanks, Linda, for that, as usual, insightful testimony and also some scripture as well. We really appreciate that. What we're going to do now, we're going to now turn to the Facebook Live and also on the Zoom to see anyone who may want to give whoever wants to get a tribute to either a family person they know that lost someone to suicide, or a veteran that know that lost to suicide. So I'm going to put my face on our brother. And we can start now reading what's in the Facebook Live. Go ahead.
There we go. I'm sorry, can you hear me now?
Yep.
Slight technical difficulties there. You can hear me now, though, yeah? So thank you, everybody. That's so moving. So moving and so much good information. Yes, go get help. Make a phone call. Call somebody. So the on the Facebook Live, somebody has said that they want to pay tribute to Specialist Derek Landers from the Army Reserve on June 14th, 2015. So thank you so much for, let's give him tribute for his ultimate sacrifice. That seems to be it right now for people who want to give tribute, but tribute to anyone else who wants to post that on Facebook, we'd be very happy to share that.
Luis, you're allowed to talk, Luis. Councilman Luis.
Hey, thank you so much, Ellsworth. I appreciate it. This is Tampa City Councilman Luis Vieira. Can everybody hear me?
We can hear you.
Loud and clear.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Just wanted to thank everybody for all of your hard work in making this happen today. It's so important that people know that Memorial Day is not only about individuals who have lost their lives due to death suffered during active service, but due to causes that occur after active service, whether it's due to mental health challenges, suicide, or other things like Agent Orange, for example. And we've seen great Americans lose their lives 20, 30 years after service in Vietnam. You know, the main thing that I heard today is just shared humanity, which is that we all suffer from mental health challenges, no matter who we are. I can tell you that I certainly have in my own life. I'm 42 years old, and I've undergone, I've suffered from depression. I've suffered from anxiety. We all have. It doesn't make you weak to admit that. Like I tell folks, if you have a broken bone, you're going to go to an orthopedic surgeon. And if you suffer from depression, then you ought to get help. And that disproportionately affects our veterans. So thank you guys so much for all that you do. Thank you for your humanity, for your empathy, and for your compassion, and for your strength. Thank you very much for all that you do, and God bless you. Thank you.
Hey, thanks, Councilman. One thing I wanted just to have you on here too is that one of the things, as this COVID thing keeps going longer and longer, we're going to have a lot more mental health problems going on. People who never thought about suicide in February are thinking about it now with so much stuff going on. So I'm hoping that the city and anybody else is doing stuff to prepare for that. And definitely Veterans Council Veterans want to be part of that. So you need our assistance, let us know. But we definitely got to be ready when this thing finally starts and let itself go for the mental health of us.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Liz. Now I want to bring in Larry. Larry, so Carol's right here too. So I guess you know each other. So yeah, I feel like I've known Joan for years, for the last couple of years. I tell you what, I wish I had a chance to meet him, but we appreciate that.
Do we want to try Larry again? Larry, let me try and unmute him. It's not letting me unmute him.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. No, we might have lost Larry.
Okay, so I don't see anybody on the Facebook that want to give a tribute?
No, that's it. I mean, and I get that. You know, it's very personal thing. So thank you to those that did share. And those who aren't comfortable sharing, you know, we're all in it together, and you're all in our hearts.
And I know that Murtis mentioned something, and Murtis has been with us a lot, part of our VLOS, and how she lost her son, who was in that strange period when he was reserved, and called on active duty, and, you know, that's that little no man's land and stuff like that, and she's a great speaker, too. I definitely feel for Murtis and for Derek. And there's several of them that I guess who are not on who are that I know of that at least six or seven of them died. Colonel Green, a Marine, died at Bay Pines last year. So, but like we said, this is something that's got to be continuing. If this stuff picks up, people will start feeling more comfortable doing this. So, but until then, call for a second to get someone to be a panelist to give the benediction and the task. One second.
Oh, looks like we're having a few more technical difficulties there. Hopefully Ellsworth will just come right back and join us. Just just want to take the time to say thanks, everybody, for watching, and thanks for being a part of this.
Difficulties. We're now going to be the primitive rendition of Taps. This will be performed by J.R. Scoggins for the American Legion Post 5 and the director of the Honor Guard. Thanks, JR. Now we will be closing the ceremony with a benediction by Chaplain Linda Pugsley.
Dear Lord, even though we may have heavy hearts as we remember those who have left us, I pray that we can be showered with your grace and mercy now and always. And in that grace and mercy, may we all find comfort, strength, and renewal. By ourselves, we know this is difficult, but with you, all things are possible. Bless each and everyone listening in tonight. May we remain bonded, not broken, in tragedy, in order to lift up and sustain each other. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Before we close, I want you to take away this as you lead the service. Some people may have, you know, had asked me, Tony, why are you having this particular day on Memorial Day? Shouldn't you have another day that's not part of Memorial Day? And I say to them, now, anybody out there who's a veteran and knows that a veteran, when we go to Memorial Day, we don't distinguish between today and tomorrow. We just know we lost a veteran. And so one part of that is that as a veteran, that doesn't pass because we don't look at that like that. Now I can understand a fan person, they may grieve differently and want to own that grief. And maybe they may feel like Memorial Day may not be the perfect place for that. And for me, again, as Carol kind of mentioned with the firefighter, you know, a lot of veterans who died by PTSD, depression, they got it over there. It just detonated here. So a lot of that stuff is combat related and it still has a place. But when I look at Memorial Day is for me and for a lot of us, it's not just for those who died in combat in action, but it's our brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers who died, who served this country, gave their life to the country in one way or the other. That's what I do when I sit there and I give observance for Memorial Day to all the brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers and sisters and uncles who died. So just saying that in that point there. So. We got the best way to end the stigma is sometimes we find ourselves that part of that stigma. The best way to end the stigma is to have events like this and not feel like we're shunned to be shamed not doing it. So to that, for those out there, and hopefully we'll have more events like this so we can eliminate the stigma when it comes to dying by suicide. Until then, Tony Williams, Veterans Council of Veterans, thank you very much for attending this. Tony Williams out.